Max, why don't you help me through the agenda today, if you can? But Judge Cassidy's here. Somebody said Judge Cassidy is here. No? Okay. All righty. Well, if there are no objections, we'll call the meeting to order. And for those of you who may be new to this committee, Max Conyers is always highly reliable for taking us through the agenda. And so I'm not going to challenge that protocol whatsoever, Max. I'm going to let you go right along and help
Hopefully
me, okay?
Not. I'm not thank too you. Forward.
There we go.
Okay, thank you, Mayor. And I just want to say, first meeting of 2011, I just surely appreciate you all making your way through the storm, the snow, to get to be here. And it looks like we are just over a quorum, so I am much appreciated for our action items. So the first item on there is we were going to ask you all to approve the minutes from our last meeting of October 27th, 2010. Hopefully you've had a chance, a pretty summary, so there's not a lot of detail.
So there is a move to approve the minutes by Councilmember Crosby. Is there a second? Second, Rocky. Is there any discussion on the minutes? All in favor, please indicate by saying aye. All opposed, no. Motion carries. Minutes are approved.
Thank you, Mayor.
Is the next a call for citizen or public comment?
Yes, Mayor.
Is there anyone in the audience who wishes to offer a public comment? All right. Hearing none, then we can proceed with the agenda.
Thank you, Mayor.
Can you give help us here with the item number three, if you would?
Item number three, I just wanted to say thank you to our past TPC members, Sandra Varelas, who was the Fayette County Judge Executive, and she had been a long member, and we just want to say thank you for her service to the Transportation Policy Committee, and also Mrs. Cheryl Feigl, Council Member Feigl. She was very engaged and active and really helped us, our transportation planning process a lot. Just want to say thank you to those two past members, and then also wanted to say thank you to and welcome to the new members, Council Member Kay and I think
Chris Frost.
Right, Chris Frost is here for representing
Chris
Councilman
Ford.
Blues.
Chris Ford, I said Chris Frost.
Right. And he is substituting for Councilmember Blues, who had an appointment today, and I sure appreciate that. And that happens quite a bit with busy elected officials. So it's wonderful that you all can attend our policy committee when needed. And that's basically it, Mayor. I just wanted to say welcome to the new and thank you to the past members.
Right. Thank you, sir. All right. Next on the agenda is a TPC discussion and action to establish a TPC chair and vice chair officers. This is for the coming year, right?
Yes, for 2011. We're at a point where Mayor Newberry of Fayette County, you know, chaired for 2 years, and our bylaws state that the chair should rotate every 2 years, but can have two consecutive two-year terms. So it can go 2 years or 4 years for a certain county. After 4 years, it has to switch to the other county, and that would be between mayors and judge executives for the chair. And I guess that's the one thing that we need to officially do, ask you all to do here, is to officially designate a chair and vice chair for 2011.
Could I make a suggestion on
yes.
that? And let's see if the protocol will allow it. I'd appreciate if we could defer this perhaps to the next meeting.
Yes.
I don't know if that would be allowed, but I'd like to talk to Judge Cassidy about that and see from his experience. He's been involved and active in it for a very long time. And get his suggestions as to the best approach to this, if that'd be all right with the
That's totally acceptable within the prospectus, Mayor. I think that's totally acceptable within our prospectus. There's nothing in there that says that's not, and I think that's probably the best to have you all have the discussion.
Right. Okay. We had a conversation just last week, but it didn't hit on this. A bunch of other things, but we didn't quite get to this one.
Right.
So. If that would be appropriate and acceptable to the body, then we'll do that. Do we need a motion to that effect?
I don't believe so. I don't think so.
All right.
I think
great. Mm-hmm. And we'll have a recommendation by the next meeting.
Thank you.
Okay. The next item on the agenda, the next item is information and discussion items. So you ready for that, Max?
Yes, Mayor.
Thank you, sir.
First item, I just wanted to give you a brief overview, especially the new members. I know a lot of you have probably seen some of the materials and videos and orientation items that we've given out, but just for the new members, I thought we would show this brief video. It's under 10 minutes, and it's really good. It's very valid. It summarizes just about everything within the MPO process and I think it's tailored to the decision makers, to the policy board. So I thought if you could bear with us, you could view this, and it pretty much hits everything in a very efficient and general manner. And then, of course, we're able to meet with you all one-on-one anytime. I have the document that summarizes everything within the transportation planning process. I'd like to give that to the new members. And if you all don't mind, I'll do this slight orientation video. Go ahead, Rob.
Transportation is the backbone of our communities. We rely on it every day to get us to work, to get us to shopping and recreation, and to bring us goods and services. But who makes the decisions about our transportation system, and how are those decisions made? This video is an introduction to Metropolitan Transportation Planning and the role of Metropolitan Planning Organizations. Over the last 100 years or more, America's population and lines of commerce have expanded well beyond the boundaries of individual cities and towns. Today, networks of highways, transit services, freight carriers, and airports serve metropolitan areas that may include many cities, suburbs, towns, and counties. In today's urban areas, many transportation decisions are best handled at the regional level. A regional approach gives decision makers a comprehensive understanding of transportation problems and the ability to develop comprehensive solutions. Over the years, Congress has promoted a regional approach to urban transportation planning and decision making. One of the most important advances came in the 1970s with legislation that required the creation of Metropolitan Planning Organizations, or MPOs, in areas with a population of 50,000 or more. Now, there are over 300 MPOs across the country. An MPO may be a freestanding planning organization or an association of local governments, but every MPO is governed by a policy board of locally elected officials. The board may also include representatives from state transportation departments, mass transit operators, and others. The MPO is not alone in the decision-making process, but it's the engine that drives collaboration and cooperation among many participants. Local elected officials bring a unique perspective to the planning and decision-making process. They often face a challenging balancing act, making decisions that have the greatest regional benefit, while at the same time reflecting the concerns of the communities they represent. MPOs and their partners produce three key documents. the Unified Planning Work Program, the Transportation Plan, and the Transportation Improvement Program. The Unified Planning Work Program, or UPWP, describes the planning studies that are being performed for the metropolitan area. The Transportation Plan identifies the region's transportation policies, strategies, and projects for the next 20 years or more. The Transportation Improvement Program, or TIP, is a short-range program of projects covering at least 3 years that directs available funds to those improvements that are the highest priority. The MPO Policy Board and its partners direct the development and contents of the plan, the TIP and the UPWP. Both the plan and the TIP must be fiscally constrained, in other words, consistent with available and expected funds. In areas with air quality problems, the plan and the TIP must also help the region meet federal standards. Let's now look at how the plan and the TIP are prepared. Often, the local planning participants start with a regional vision or a set of goals. This vision expresses what the region would like to become, perhaps 40 or 50 years in the future.
Well, important elements of a long-range plan are obviously in a strong statement of goals and values. What is it that we're after in the transportation system of the future?
In developing a vision or goals, the MPO may consider many questions. What are the trends in regional growth, and are they desirable? How well is the transportation system performing? Do existing plans deal with current and expected problems? Can the transportation system support the kinds of future development that the region desires? When the vision and goals are in place, the MPO and its partners are better able to identify transportation problems and needs. These can include declining mobility, increasing congestion, poor access to jobs and neighborhoods, unhealthy air, or inconsistency with proposed economic development. An understanding of these problems allows the MPO and its partners to identify alternatives to improve transportation. Alternatives may include new policies, operational strategies, or capital projects. Some may help the existing system work better. Others may expand or build new transit lines, highways, and other facilities. Another round of questions is asked in assessing the impact of alternatives. How well does each alternative address the region's transportation problems? What are the likely impacts on neighborhoods and the environment? How much do the alternatives cost? Are the funds there? And is this the best use of available resources? The answers to these questions help the board choose the best alternatives. By adopting the transportation plan, the board establishes the policies, strategies, and projects that the region will pursue. To develop the TIP, priority projects are drawn from the adopted transportation plan and matched with available funding. Once adopted by the MPO, the TIP is submitted to the state and becomes part of the statewide transportation improvement program. But the process doesn't end here. Projects and strategies in the plan and TIP undergo further development, often including engineering and environmental studies. Also, many MPOs monitor the implementation of the plan and TIP, study how well the plan is working, and make periodic adjustments. Federal rules require that the plan be updated and readopted every 3 to 5 years, and the TIP every 2 years.
Long-range planning, it is an ongoing process. It's not etched in stone, and many people don't realize that, and new board members don't realize that either, that it's not a plan that's etched in stone, that it's constantly in an updating process.
Agency and public involvement is a key activity in every step of the planning process. The public refers to a variety of individuals, agencies, and organizations, each with different interests and levels of involvement. Many different approaches are used to inform and engage other agencies and the public.
Our public participation is not just at the MPO level, and that's one of the things we try to emphasize at the municipal level. It is not just the MPO calling a meeting. No, it is the MPO participating in other meetings and forums that may have been called by other, whether city or state agencies.
Transportation planning continues to evolve. New issues are emerging that demand innovation and creativity from MPOs. Many MPOs today are working with other local and state agencies and the private sector to provide multimodal systems that give people more choices. Transit, carpooling, bicycling, walking. Better connections between highways, transit, airports, freight, and other modes of transportation can make the entire system work more efficiently.
We can't solve our transportation problem in key corridors just by widening the roads anymore. We have to provide some additional modal opportunities for the traveling public. And by focusing on rapid transit in conjunction with roadway improvements, we think we can add significant capacity for the traveling public.
Coordinating transportation and land use can be challenging. While transportation decisions are made at the state and regional levels, most land use decisions are made by local governments and private developers. The MPO may be the only place where officials from different jurisdictions can coordinate land use and transportation planning for the region as a whole. Many MPOs are partnering with state transportation departments, transit operators, and other agencies to preserve existing transportation assets and to squeeze more capacity out of their existing systems.
Probably for 40 years, we chased congestion, and congestion was our number one goal. Addressing congestion was our number one goal. But now we're recognizing that preserving the existing system, our bridges and our highways and our transit systems, and the safety of that system are, in fact, more important goals, and we recognize them, and that's part of our vision, to create a system that's not only safe, but is well-maintained and preserved, particularly in the core of our region.
Planners are also making greater efforts to respond to the needs of all the users of transportation systems, people of every age, ethnic group, and income level, because mobility is a link to opportunity and equality. For elected officials and citizens alike, metropolitan transportation planning is a tremendous opportunity to build better communities.
I think I went into it not realizing, you know, that I was in a much wider, bigger area that had dramatic impacts until I got into the process and began to experience, you know, what other towns were going through and seeing and learning from their mistakes and learning their ideas. And I think that's one of the rich rewards of the MPO process.
It's an exciting position to be in. You do have input. You're representing your communities. And I think anybody that wants to get involved in this should.
It is basically a collaborative approach among the jurisdictions within a metropolitan region. There are some federal rules and laws that guide how we have to go through the process. But the real success of MPOs is based on the ability of the leaders of the jurisdictions to be able to collaborate to achieve a common goal.
Okay, thank you for bearing with us. And I think that covered it all in a very quick period. And you see those three key documents that were covered in there. It's our Unified Planning Work Program, which we're going to talk about in a little bit. It's annual that shows all the planning work we're going to do for the money we receive. And you also have the long-range transportation plan, which there is called the Metropolitan Transportation Plan, long-range vision, 20 years or more. And then we have our transportation improvement program, where we have programmed monies into the projects of the highest priority. And we have those documents for you, and they're online and available at all times. And like the lady said in the video, that they're not etched in stone. They're constantly changing and reevaluating, and the decision makers are helping to mold those as we go from one snapshot in time to the next. You know, so. I guess that's plenty, and as far as an orientation, and that's going to help, I think, lead into some of our other items as we go. So I just wanted to get that out of the way. Just any questions, I'd be glad to answer. But like I said, I'd be glad to meet one-on-one or answer any detailed questions at any time for you all.
Just as a suggestion, from having been involved, Max, that idea of having a maybe an orientation, maybe a little deeper, might be useful to schedule that around some of the new members,
mm-hmm.
Even the elderly members,
right.
Like myself,
yeah.
Reacquaint us with mission and purpose and process would be worthwhile.
Love to do that. And actually, we talked about that in our statewide planning meeting, you know, with our state and state officials and our federal officials. They suggested that too. And so that would be perfect. And we'll just go ahead and schedule a brief orientation.
Okay.
We can bury members in too much detail, I know, but we can also be more efficient.
I think as much as possible, taking back, digging into the history.
Yes.
Origins, purpose, the development of our own model here,
mm-hmm.
that history, the accomplishments, signal accomplishments, milestones, bumps in the road, rocks in the road that have been experienced over time, and reacquainting us with the current plan, and then what the next steps are that are going to be expected in the next few years. Maybe that's part of today. And this is really more an update on projects, isn't it?
Yes, we have several of our required documents and things that we're asking you for approval today.
So what I was suggesting just now would be different than what the agenda calls for
today,
right?
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
I guess what I'm thinking is more of the strategic, the history.
Mm-hmm.
Again, history of the model here, milestones, accomplishments, some of the bumps in the road, the rocks in the road, euphemistically, otherwise called not successes or failures,
mm-hmm.
And what's imagined going forward.
Mm-hmm. I think we can
anything
do that.
Else? Anybody else got any suggestions on what would be good for Steve? You're good at this kind of stuff.
Yeah, I guess just a little bit of time on what are the key issues at the moment? What's coming down the road? What do we really need to be thinking about and focusing on? Be helpful.
Right. I think and we had wanted to do that after we had our long-range plan adopted, to get into the detail of that. We never did have that opportunity because there was some changes in, council members and or policy committee members and so forth. So this would be a good opportunity for us to develop that and you would want probably the whole board to be or the whole committee to be involved or not or just new members or you thinking?
Well, I think issue the invitation to everybody.
Okay.
And who will be able to make it then can.
Great.
You just mentioned the long range. Is that the language? Long range plan?
They call it, they switched about a year and a half ago into Metropolitan Transportation Plan, MTP for short.
Right. Right.
And it used to be called long-range transportation plan, and that's what it is, but it's just new terminology, Metropolitan Transportation Plan. And it has to be 20 years or more.
That's mandated, right? By?
Federal Highway
Administration. Required by federal, okay.
Yes.
So I think part of this would be any requirements. It's what picking up on what Councilmember Kay just said, any requirements downstream that could be illustrated in a schedule.
Right. There seems to be always constant new requirements coming, so that would be very relevant.
And valid. Okay.
Okay.
Right. Well, Thank you.
We'll get that together. Thank you, Mayor. So that, if that's all on number one, I can move into our number two. And that is, just wanted to let you all know that all TMAs, another acronym, we are just overloaded with acronyms. TMA is what's called a transportation management area. There are three in Kentucky, Northern Kentucky, Louisville, and us, Central Kentucky. And there are over 200,000 population. And that means we have a lot more requirements federal and state requirements, but we also get more resources. We get more money to do those things. And and we have to meet those provisions and so forth. So every 3 years, the TMAs or MPOs have to be certified by the federal government. So basically what that means is the FHWA teams with the FTA, Federal Transit Administration, and the Federal Highway Administration. They put together a team, and they come to our area and conduct what's called a certification review process. And basically, they go over every required provision of the latest legislation, which is Safety Lou. I'm sure you've heard that, safe, accountable. I'm not even going to try. I could get it if I went real slow, but it's the latest transportation legislation. And just wanted to let you know that that is scheduled tentatively right now. And it's June 21st and 22nd. And basically what they'll be doing is coming and doing a field review first. And what that means is we'll ride around our area and look at all of our projects and programs and so forth that we have going on. In the past, Rocky and Lexitran has been very good. They help organize that trip, and we look at transit projects, and we look at transit facilities and so forth, and we go and we look at all the new projects and programs that we have going on, and full informity for the team. They see what we put into it.
Hey, Max.
Yes.
Can I pause you for just a second?
Yes.
Mayor, I know that we have a quorum right now, and I know Councilmember Crosby and I both have to leave here soon. Can I circumvent the informational stuff, and can we go to the action item so that you've got a quorum to vote?
That would be fine with me.
The reason I
put those at the end was so everybody could get oriented to what we're doing. But I think
appreciate
it's very
it.
Practical.
I want to make sure that you've got the quorum to vote for what you need to get done. So,
right.
Mayor, if you don't mind.
Sure thing.
Moving
sure thing.
Thank you.
Yep.
Thank you. Very practical. I appreciate that. Would you like me to just move into them, Mayor?
Yes, sir. Go right ahead.
Okay. All right, first one, as you know, we have our Transportation Improvement Program. That's our document that shows where we're putting our funding. And we have two items that we'd like to inform you of, and then one to ask for a motion. Number one is Administrative Modification Number 12. This is the 12th modification we've made to our TIP. And if you look on page 12, you can see exactly what that entails. Let's see here. Which page is that? Page 9. And basically, it's a very it's kind of a formality and some changes. If you look, we're adding $60,000 of SLX funds to the Kentucky 169 culvert replacement project, and then also $645,000 in interstate maintenance, which the state takes care of for the Federal Highway Administration, and gets pretty technical with that maintenance. But that's basically all we're doing, is adjusting those amounts and adding those amounts. Very easy to do, and we just need to inform you of that. It doesn't really require a motion. But the second one is pretty big changes. We're adding funding, we're changing funding, we're changing phasing and funding sources and so forth. So therefore, we have to conduct what's called an amendment, and basically we have to put it in the Herald Leader, the Jessamine Journal. We have to do a 15-day public review and address any comments that we may receive in that 15-day public review. That public review ends this Friday, and so far we haven't gotten any comments, but one of the main things we're doing here is two, I'll just briefly let you know, is if you look on page 12, we're adopting the formed livability principles. And I'm proud to say our plan and our TIP and our comprehensive land use plans and so forth, we already have these principles within our plans and so forth. They're just not in this format that just came out. But I'm proud to say we have each one of these livability principles. If you look, there's six of them, and they talk about providing more transportation choices and so forth, supporting existing communities and enhancing economic competitiveness and those kind of things. And they're very good for any community to adopt those kind of principles. But the FHWA and the EPA had come out there was like three agencies, the EPA, the Federal Highway Administration, the Housing Department. They all had different principles, and they were all in different language, basically meaning the same thing. They combined them into this one principle. So, and now the federal government would like us to formally adopt this language. And so we're just asking that you adopt these into our long-range plan and our TIP.
Motion to adopt.
Second.
Motion and a second. Is there any discussion? Hearing none. Yeah. Councilmember Crosby.
I just want to make sure that what you're changing with the schedules, that's listed on pages, I think, 15 through, is that where you're talking about changes in the?
Yes, and what that is involved in is reconciling our transportation improvement program with the state transportation improvement program. And, you know, the legislature came out and with a brand new state transportation improvement program, and we have to reconcile those two. Those have to be in agreement. I don't know if Mr. Barry Howes might want to add to that, but from the state, but that's basically all we're doing is adding to.
So the priorities are still the same from what I can tell. It's just making it consistent with the state.
Yes.
Okay.
Say if it's a project and maybe a phase changed because you had delay on right-of-way or something and you shifted it to the following fiscal year or something, those
enough.
Kind
that,
of things.
That answers it. Thank you.
Right. You're welcome. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Any other comments, questions? All right. Hearing none. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. Motion carries.
Thank you, Mayor, and I just want to let you know also we have to have a resolution signed, but we thought we'd wait until the public review period was up, which is this coming Friday, and then we will bring that to you for your signature or Judge Cassidy, whichever. And it's no big hurry on that, so you know we can do that in a week or so.
Great. Okay, thanks. Mm-hmm. Thanks, Max.
Thank you. All right, next action item. This is, I'll go for this real quickly because basically it's a formality. We have to start the completion of Polo Club Boulevard in our transportation improvement program. We have SLX funds programmed towards that. It was a priority that we put into our TIP. And basically, Mr. House recognized that road had not been officially designated on the federal functional class system as a collector. Only collector and above functional class is eligible for federal funding. So we have we had a little problem there. To overcome that, there's a special process seldomly used, but basically Barry found a case in Louisville where it was used to change the functional class system before it was completed. And as you know, Polo Club is not completed, but that you can use this process to designate it, knowing it will be completed as a collector, in the near future. So basically what we're asking, and it has to come, when you're in an MPO area, it has to come from the MPO body to send that recommendation to the state, and then the state will make that recommendation to the federal government and so forth. So that's all I'm asking is that.
Motion to recommend.
Mm-hmm.
It's a motion and a second to recommend approval. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. The motion carries. Do we? You said earlier we did not need votes on, but was that just that one? We do need them now, right?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Right.
I just want to make sure.
Right. And we will draft that letter and send that letter on. That's all we have to do now since you all have approved that.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Those are two big items that we needed to take care of. Now I'll move into number three, which is this proposal to officially adopt the Transportation Policy Committee MPO meeting schedule for 2011. Basically, if you look on page 34, there's the meeting schedule. We have five meetings planned. It's not out of the question that we have to have a special meeting sometimes, but five meetings to convene you all and ask you to do things that we need to do, and just want to officially adopt that schedule, and that's it.
Motion and a second. Any discussion? All right, hearing none, all in favor, please say aye. All opposed, no. Motion carries.
Great. And as far as I was told by my staff and Chris to remind me that if you want to talk about this now, or we could move on, but it's basically there was a proposal to move the time of this meeting to 2:30 from some people. Councilmember Gordon especially would like to do that. It kind of conflicts with her job, her nursing job, and she would like to attend. And I think that's why it was put in to have a discussion about that. But I don't know if that's a good time for that right now, Mayor.
Yeah, we can take it up now.
Okay.
Anybody have a comment? I saw Councilmember Crosby.
I like the 1:30 time personally. If it's moved to 2:30, I think I probably would have a conflict. Thank you.
It's been at 1:30 for some time.
As long as I've been here, and it's been a long time. But, you know, as far as the staff, it's no problem. I think it's just, and we don't have to decide this today if you want to talk about it, think about it, but, you know, that's just.
We have the forward schedule set, right, for how long?
1:30. The problem, I guess, would be we have this out, we have it on all our, you know, our GTV3 and our websites and things. Right?
So. So adjusting it can affect other schedules. That's one of the reasons, too.
Right.
Other meetings and other things as well, right? When is the next meeting?
The next meeting would be in April 27th, that'd be a 1:30 at this point in time. And it will be here in the council chambers. We, as you know, we have to have two meetings in Jessamine County, according to our...
Okay, is there any other discussion on... Anybody else have a comment on it? It doesn't sound like that there's a strong urgency to adjust it right now, so
okay.
We'll talk to Councilmember Gordon about it and see if we need to consider it again. Mm-hmm. Okay?
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Max. Anything else?
I guess that's
in terms of action items.
That's
okay.
It. Yeah, that's that.
All right.
Thank you all
Councilmember
very
Cord,
much.
Councilmember Cord, Councilmember Crosby, you all need to go. Thank you. Okay, great.
Thank you. All right, I will move back into the informational discussion items and try to move through them quick because I know you all are busy. And number three, if you look on our agenda, basically just wanted to let you all know of the required annual obligations report that we have published and put out. Was submitted to the KYTC and the FHWA. It's on our website. And basically, this is just a requirement under the United States Code and under our process that says we will, it's like open and transparency type of requirement that shows all authorized, committed, and awarded federal projects. And that includes FTA projects, too, not just federal highway projects. And that would be awarded to the state, because the state actually gets federal funding. It would be awarded to our urbanized area, the MPO, and also to the designated recipient of federal transit funds. So if you look on those pages, it's a lot of tables, a lot of information, but that's basically every project that received federal funding in 2010, this past year. And I just wanted to let you know that is there, and if any of your constituents or anybody would be wanted to know about which projects receive federal funding, that's the listing, the required listing. All right.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Okay, moving on to informational item number four. As you had seen on our video, we have to do an annual Unified Planning Work Program. Basically, that document is an annual document that lays out all the planning work that we will do this coming fiscal year. And it has many elements, transit planning, traffic modeling, surveillance, land use planning, all these types of things, congestion management, all these types of things that are fall within safety lieu and the Code of Federal Regulations that that says we need to do and meet these provisions. And that's basically due by the end of next month. We have to have a draft out. So basically, we'll be submitting a draft to out put out for comments from all stakeholder agencies. I'll send you all a copy, and you can look over it. If you have any comments or anything, make sure and get them back to me and the staff, and we'll make those considerations, changes. And then the actual document has to be completed, I believe, May, by the 1st of May. So we'll be coming to you in April at that meeting we just mentioned, April, to ask for approval of that Unified Planning Work document. So that's all it is. I just wanted to give you the heads up that that's coming, and it'll lay out all the planning work that we are proposing to have to do for to meet the requirements, and just make sure that that you all get the copy and get to review it.
Right, sir.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thanks, Max.
All right. Item number five, I just wanted to let you know there's a big project. I guess this would be termed almost a mega project in our area, is the Eastern Nicholasville Bypass. And there's a public meeting on Thursday, which is tomorrow, right? That's tomorrow. That's coming right up. But it's in Nicholasville. The state is the project managers of that. We've contributed greatly. We did the forecasting, the project forecasting, incorporating all the land use plans, and then generating trips and modeling that on the system, in the future system. And that will be presented, you know, the future forecast and turning movements and so forth. State will have all the latest design alternatives and so forth. And that will be held tomorrow. There's been meeting notices in the Herald Leader, Adjustment Journal, but if you look on page 8, gives all the information. It'll be from 5 to 7, and it'll be at the City County Park at the end of Longview Drive in Nicholasville. And we'll be down there to hopefully answer questions if there's any questions needed from us. But just wanted to let you all know that it's a big project, and it has money getting started in the design and so forth. So. Did you have anything to add, David?
Only that Jessamine County is very grateful for your support.
Thanks, sir.
All right. Thank you.
All right, sir.
Did you have anything, Mayor, on that? Or?
Not right now. That's great.
Okay.
Yep.
I will move on then to item number 6. And 7, basically, cover them at the same time. This is an area where we like to have engineers, the project engineers in the audience, to answer any questions that you may have on any Fayette County projects or Jessamine County projects. They know these things of how the projects are progressing and the problems or the issues or the good things that are happening. And just wanted to ask if you had any questions. I have Mr. Bob Barrett. We have Kinsey Gleason on bike and ped issues. And usually the state would be here too, but I had an email from Randy Turner and Brett Blair that they couldn't make it today, and they were very apologetic. They had a conflict with a rural projects meeting, and they vowed to be here next time. But we can get any information you like on any state projects if you'd like us to follow up. So also, Mayor Newberry, I think when he was chairing, he wanted to have regular reporting on Newtown Pike Extension. So if there's any projects, Mayor, that you would like us to regularly report on as just a regular agenda item, we'd be glad to do that for members. And that's basically it. Just to ask if you have any questions.
Yeah, I'd say any of these headliner projects, like the bypass that we're just mm-hmm. talking about.
Okay.
Newtown, yeah.
Okay. We'll do that, Mayor. We'll have regular reports.
What other ones would you say that would be?
Well, Newtown reached a pretty big milestone to get that
right,
one,
right, right.
But the other phases are moving right along.
I think we need to hear from that routinely.
We usually had Andrew Grunwald.
Meeting quarterly, so routine accountability on those would be worthwhile. I mean, and that's what I'm saying. Any others that I said headliners, that's, you know, basically.
You mentioned in your State of the Emerged Government Address, Clay's Mill. I know that.
Clay's Mill?
Yes.
Right. I was thinking Clay's Mill. Was that one?
Right. And I picked that one out of your speech last night. I said, I'd like to report to you.
You want to talk about two-way traffic in downtown, too? That was a joke.
Right. That's complex, but we can talk about it. Right.
If you've got any magic wands that you can wave, that'd be great. Right.
Yeah. Roger just mentioned to me that Leestown was Leestown.
Yeah, Leestown. It would be super. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Y'all got any others? Dave?
Great. Well, I can have Bob, or maybe the state folks, you know, stand up and just...
Yep, that'd be great.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you.
Max?
Yes?
Over here. Before I leave, I think I did this in a council meeting, but I publicly thanked Roger in your office because you all were wonderful during the World Equestrian Games, and since we haven't had a meeting since that time about the communication with road closures and what to expect and updating it constantly, it was very helpful. I know a lot of the constituents in the 7th District appreciated being able to get messages through all different types of means, and I think you all have been very creative with some of the things you've done to get information out to the community. So I had thanked you all in a council meeting. You may not have heard it, but I thought we should thank you in person because it was very helpful.
Thank you very much. I surely appreciate that. Roger works very hard. He's very passionate about that and very good at it. And we all worked with the staff, and it's good to get a thank you for that, because we take it very seriously, and it's utilized a lot from the public. We have Facebook and Twitter we're using now, and I believe Roger, last we are the number 2 MPO in the country, or.
As far as the MPOs that I've found, I've been able to find 49 that are using Twitter, and we're number 8. But for under 1 million population, we're number 1. And for Facebook, I was able to find 52 so far, and we're about at 14. But I plan on bringing us up quite a bit from there, so I'll keep working on it.
So thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks, Councilmember Crosby. Anything else? Nope. All right. Okay, Max.
Okay. That is it for the informational items, I believe. Let's see, make sure yes. And I just wanted to hit 3 things and then ask you if you had any other things you'd like to discuss. Number one, we'll be bringing American with Disabilities Act transition plans to you later on for approval to adopt. That's required, a requirement, and we'll be bringing that in the future. Our unscheduled projects list, we'll be bringing that to you in the future. And just want to let you know there's a huge effort and educational effort and outreach to get rid of, or I guess delete, distracted driving. It's a huge problem in our right now, and so you're seeing that from the state and the federal government. A lot of resources going into cutting down and educating on and the dangers of distracted driving, and that's basically it. I just want to open up the floor to if you all have anything that you would like to ask or add before we adjourn.
Got a question,
Rocky,
Mayor?
Yes, sir.
Probably back before Christmas, the Federal Transit Administration called me and asked what I knew about a grant of about $300,000 to study light rail and other transit alternatives in the area. And it was supposedly awarded to the mayor's office, and that was the old regime. So I just wondered if anybody knows anything about that. A lot of people are asking questions. I know the University of Kentucky has got a similar study going on. So it just would be nice if we could have a, you know, collaborative effort with that. I didn't know where the what was going on with that.
Right. We had the same inquiry, and we followed up. We talked with Mike Webb, and he asked the mayor, and didn't really know details about it. The mayor Newberry had known that he had talked to Mr. Chandler at a luncheon about it, I believe, and but we really didn't get much more information than that. But it is a we look if you look on the federal earmark under Ben Chandler's earmarks, it is a $300,000 for to study transit alternatives in our area, and just we need to find more out about
somebody
it.
I heard that question circulating myself, Rocky, and Jeff Reed was checking on it, who formerly worked for Congressman Chandler. So we'll get Jamie's here, so he'll check on it for us. Did you find out you hadn't?
I didn't get any details more other than the basic, and so I think it's a great thing. It's a great thing, so we need to follow up on it. But it's of course Rocky's position, Lextran's the designated recipient for that money, so that would be. But I believe isn't. I believe they listed from the FTA regional said that the Urban County Government was the sponsor. Or
well,
the,
that was the issue. You know, it's one of those things. It was a discretionary grant, so it didn't come through the Federal Transit Administration, so they won't necessarily be overseeing it. But of course, their comment was, if anything comes from the study and we want to build something, then the money will come through the FTA. And Lextran, being the local recipient for all those funds, would want to be involved. So they just continue to ask me the question, and, and I'm just trying to help.
Okay. Well, we will follow up on that. I promise.
Councilmember Kay.
As it happens, I just got off the Lextran board, so I'm a little bit familiar with this issue. It seems to me that the question really is, what is the status of those funds? And that's what nobody seems to know. The original question was, where'd they come from? Not to be flip about it, but who cares? We want to know.
Good point.
Yeah, we want to know what the status is and who's responsible and how that use of that money going forward is going to be determined.
That's all I have, Mayor, unless you all have anything.
All right. Does anybody else have any comments or questions? Anything to bring before us? All right. Is there a motion to adjourn then? Motion by Councilmember Kay. Second by Seacrest. Councilmember Ford's ready to give a second. All right. Thank you all very much for being here today. All that the staff does before I take this vote, we really appreciate you guys. Do great work and appreciate it. Thanks so much.
And
for everybody who participated and came up here in the snow, thank you very much. All in favor, please say aye to adjourn. All opposed, no. We are adjourned. Thank you.
Thank you. Have a safe.